Okay. So it's my pleasure to welcome Professor Andrea Olschlich, who is our Session 7 plenary speaker. So Dr. Olschlich is professor of marine biogeochemical modeling at GEOMAR and the University of Kiel in Germany. His research interests include the global carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen cycle, and their sensitivity to environmental change, and the development and quality assessment of numerical models to investigate this. Is currently leading the Collaborative Research Center, Climate Biogeochemistry Interaction in the Tropical Oceans, and the Priority Program, Climate Engineering, Risk, Challenges, and Opportunity, both funded by the German Foundation. And today, Andreas will be presenting on sensitivity of the Eastern Tropical South Pacific Oxygen Minimum Zone to climate change. And Andreas, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Veronique, and thank you very much for getting up early or late, whatever your time zone is. My one is a little bit late, Lauren. And well, I would like to give you some overview of climate change impacts on eastern boundary uplink system with a special focus on the uplink zone of Peru, but then driving off in more general waters. Could I have just the big slide, please? I don't think you need to have to see me three times. So what is, probably set up here, sorry. Need the slides to show. Different system here.
If you do this one, yeah, it works.
All right, no,
you have to use this one.
Okay, sorry. I still don't see this show here. All right, I got it. Sorry, completely messed this up here. Can I? Not in presentation mode. So, and I have to open it again. Yes. Presentation mode.
Yes.
Okay, sorry. So now I have to speed up. The title, you saw it, and this is about eastern boundary uplink zones, regions that we have in the Atlantic and in the Pacific Oceans and both hemispheres. And the focus here, to start with, is of Peru, which is a special region of a special system in the ocean because it has very high fishery yield, about an order of magnitude higher per square meter in day and time as all the other very rich upwelling zone with high fishery yields already. There are a few hypotheses out, and maybe the experts can explain later on what is the real reason. My speculation is it's because of very shallow oxyclines in the Peru system that keep out the large predators and make food chains short, and El Niño resetting the system pretty quickly, pretty often, and thereby, allowing the system to concentrate on short and effective food change. But I'm a biogeochemist, and I would like to get better explanations from you after this talk. Concentrating on biogeochemistry, the main impact, or one main impact, is very low oxygen levels underneath the productive layers in the upwelling region. And here we see the large tropical, eastern tropical oxygen minimum zones, low oxygen concentrations going down really to zero, where new biogeochemical implications or processes appear, greenhouse gas production, nitrous oxide, methane. And this is of relevance not only for fish in the ocean, but also for climate and for us in the end. How does this all evolve? So the main controls are sluggish oxygen supply and very intensive oxygen consumption. Oxygen supply starts with oxygen uptake from the atmosphere. The atmosphere contains 99.4% of the oxygen, so really almost all of the oxygen is here in our air that we breathe. A tiny bit is in the ocean, and this enters the ocean via air-sea gas exchange in the outcrop regions. Then the oxygen has to be transported into the ocean interior. There's, apart from phytoplankton in the euphoric zone, there's no oxygen source in the interior. And this happens via advection mixing processes until oxygen is consumed by respiration of organic matter sinking down or being advected, mixed down into the ocean, to the dark ocean interior. So these are the three main controls, three main processes. And the question is now, what happens under global warming, what we are undertaking right now with our CO2 emissions? So oxygen uptake will decrease because of decreasing solubility. So any gas has a lower solubility at higher temperatures. And this is a clear, physical, well-understood process. So I think we are pretty sure about the sign. Oxygen supply will go down. Oxygen transport, well, we think it will go down because of enhanced stratification and more sluggish overturning or general circulation in the ocean. But there are some question marks, and I will show you a little more about that in a minute. Oxygen consumption, well, there the question mark becomes bigger, and we don't have very good ideas. Well, we know, or we think we know, that metabolic activity speeds up with rising temperatures, so respiration rates will increase. But overall, respiration in the ocean is not limited by rates, but by substance, by organic matter that can be respired. And this might be reduced because of decreasing nutrient supply, increasing stratification. So we're not very sure about the net change of sign in oxygen consumption. And I will go through all these processes in this presentation. There are a few more dimensions. Time and space, a third dimension comes into play. So not all the processes are local. Remote processes may matter and will matter. And an annoying aspect when you try to explain these things is that transport transports both oxygen and nutrients. And they have opposite effects in the end once circled through biology onto net oxygen changes. So we have to pay some attention to the details here. And I will try to do this. What we know is one major climate impact that we see already is ongoing deoxygenation. You saw that on the slides, on the graphic novel. This is a major threat we see right now. So the ocean has lost 2% of the oxygen over the last 50 years, and these dead zones or anoxic zones have expanded by a factor 4. This is a substantial change in the ocean, which has been overlooked for a long time. But since we have very accurate data sets going back in history with the same measurement technique, we can now diagnose this to very good accuracy. The models that we have predict an acceleration of this decline under all climate scenarios that we have used in the last IPCC report. So more warming means less oxygen, and this is ultimately the cause. Warming is the ultimate cause of deoxygenation. A slight problem is that the models do not agree very well with the hindcast that we have with the historical observations. So none of the models gets a 2% decline. They are a factor 3 or so too sluggish in the hindcast of deoxygenation. And this poses some questions about the reliable and future projections here. And we have to better understand this. But this is not the topic of this talk, just some caveat of all the model-derived conclusions I will present. But that's as good as we can do today, and we have to work on this to get a better agreement between observations and models, of course. So the agenda of this presentation is, the aspects, different aspects of climate change, warming, winds, regional and remote, until we get at the complete picture. Effects of warming. Well, this is a sketch of the zonally averaged thermocline, warm water sphere in the tropical, subtropical oceans, and it's ventilated from south and north, and there's some equatorial upwelling and different layers shown here. These are isopycnal layers, so water is primarily transported along the isopycnal layers, the different blue shading here. And outcrop regions are where oxygen can enter the ocean. What happens under warming? So we see already that isopycnals move up. Isopycnals move down, but the stratification increases, so we add new warmer layers on the top of the ocean. And individual density surfaces are closer to the surface, and the ventilation becomes shallower overall. Warming happens everywhere, almost everywhere, And this leads to outgassing, these small spirals you see in the outcrop regions. So there's some loss of oxygen from the ocean due to just solubility effects, warming of the surface waters. And if we include this in models, we see that if we run an abiotic oxygen, so there's no biology in this oxygen, just argon, then you see outgassing and loss of this abiotic tracer, oxygen tracer, due to warming. This is the solubility effect. Almost everywhere in the Arctic, you see more oxygen entering the ocean because loss of sea ice and better gas exchange, and some tiny pockets in the North Atlantic where you, the models predict some cooling, also take up more oxygen. But overall, oxygen loss due to warming. Another effect of warming is this enhanced stratification and reduced mixing. So the mixing spirals are a little bit, wiggly lines are a little bit shorter because of enhanced stratification. It becomes more difficult, needs more energy to mix across isopycnals. And this allows for a more direct ventilation of the tropical waters because tracers are not mixed away. They follow the isopycnals. The isopycnals get a little bit shallower, narrower. So as long as the wind does not change, you have to push the same amount of water through to narrower layers, isopycnal windows. And this speeds up the ventilation, the meridional ventilation in the upper ocean. And so we see more oxygenated waters, and that's actually what we also see in models. So if we run models under global warming, but with prescribed winds, no wind change here, we see the tropical thermocline gains oxygen because of this faster, shallow ventilation in the thermocline and these tighter layering of isopycnal layers. So here the conclusion is warming and enhanced stratification will lead to slight gain of oxygen in the tropical oxygen minimum zones, also in the oxygen minimum zone of Peru, as this model predicts here. So we see some, would expect some shrinking of oxygen minimum zones underneath eastern boundary uplink systems. But there is more, there's wind change. And what we have seen over the last decades is some weakening, or we poleward extension mostly of upwelling favorable winds. And there's some speculation about weakening of the zonal, of the Walker circulation in the tropical wind field. And this is a projection here from climate models under pre-industrial on the left, 2x CO2 and 4x CO2 on the right. And there's some general trend of declining wind stress or wind intensity in the tropical wind bands, the trade winds, and some poleward motion of the upwelling favorably along shore equatorward winds off South America here. This is a general picture that climate models predict for all eastern boundary upwelling systems. This is the reanalysis data compiled by Ryan here. And all these zones, regions show an intensification on poleward movement of upwelling favorably winds. What does it mean for upwelling in the eastern boundary upwelling systems? So for the Peruvian and Chilean upwelling system, this is the result of all the IPCC model ensemble. So upwelling over time, the x-axis is time over from pre-industrial to the end of the century. There's a decline of deep upwelling. The lower colored, dark colors are 300 meter upwelling. So this declines in all regions, even in the poleward regions where winds strengthen, because of the enhanced stratification. So the winds do not reach that deep anymore. The deep ocean is basically more decoupled from the surface. So upwelling of deep waters, well, deep is 300 meters to thermocline waters, declines in these projections of climate models. And only the near surface waters, they are upwelled, or upwelling rates increase. This is really volume transport on these models here. So at 30 meters, upwelling increases with increasing winds. But there's some decoupling of the deeper layers. And this has implications, again, on oxygen. And the net implication here is shown in this global map of a model projection that is driven by wind changes only in the tropical and subtropical belt between 30 north and 30 south. So weaker trade winds, the decline of the Walker circulation, weaker equatorial undercurrent, and weaker ventilation of these eastern boundary systems from the west. So they are more isolated, and more water can therefore make it from the southern latitudes or from the poleward latitudes to penetrate into the subtropical and tropical areas. So there's a net increase in oxygen here, the red, yellow and red colors, along the South American coast by more water coming from the south, from the well-ventilated high latitudes, high southern latitudes, into the tropical thermocline because of this reduced intensity of the tropical winds and tropical eastward current supply of oxygen. So basically, it's a battle between eastward supply of oxygen in the tropics versus equator water supply from high latitudes along the eastern boundary. And more oxygen-rich water is supplied from the south into the oxygen minimum zone. So again, regional winds, tropical winds, subtropical winds, predict an increase in oxygen in these areas. So it's very counterintuitive what we would expect from our deoxygenation map we saw in the beginning. But there's more. There's this remote forcing. And this is particularly Southern Ocean winds, which we have observed. They have increased over the last decades. They have moved polewards, the westerlies in the Southern Ocean. And this has implication on the entire ventilation of the thermocline of at least the Southern Hemisphere, and particularly in the Pacific. So we have seen this poleward shift of the westerlies, and this implies when we derive models with these enhanced strengthening and poleward moving winds, it results in a better ventilation, faster ventilation, so more subduction, more water mass formation. But as this happens further south, the entire subtropical gyre moves, the entire system moves poleward, moves southward. And that's what we see on this figure here. This is plotted H, so water mass H that we can diagnose perfectly well in models, unfortunately not so well in nature. But the models predict here an increasing age in the tropics and subtropics, the yellow colors. So here waters get older, less contact with the atmosphere, more time for oxygen to be consumed by respiration. And the blue colors in the southern, very poleward area of the subtropical gyre, they are better ventilated, they become younger, blue colors here. So there the enhanced winds are felt by pushing in new water, more oxygen into these waters. But the net result is a decoupling of the tropical and subtropical oxygen minimum zones from the southward moving outcrop regions and oxygen supply regions. And in our models, this really results in a huge expansion, a doubling essentially, of the volume of sub-oxic waters in the southern hemisphere and even in the global ocean here. So this is just the effect of southern hemisphere strengthening winds. Nothing else has been changed in these models, so the winds in the tropics are the same. Only southern ocean winds have been applied to this model simulation, and they produce a doubling of oxygen minimum zone volume over the century. So this is a dramatic non-local effect, and really the first red flag here that we, or red arrow that we see, a decline of oxygen concentrations in the oxygen minimum zones. But it's not a local, it's a remote effect, Southern Ocean. Trying to get at the complete picture, well, according to our model, this is again the CMIP model, CMIP 5 model comparison, the last IPCC round. Those are the models that cannot predict the 2% oxygen decline, remember that. So they underestimate by a factor of 3, if the observational estimates are right, some caveats there as well. But these models, they show some overall decline in the eastern boundary upwelling system. The agreement between models is not very good, so the stippling is not very well pronounced in this area. There are a few points that are significant, basically where models do agree. Most regions here, upwelling regions, they do not agree very well. But a slight decline of oxygen levels. Here this yellow, orange, brownish color is a decline of oxygen levels. So that would mean the Southern Ocean winds win over local effects. If we look at the volume, hypoxic volume, there's some models predict an increase, expansion, some are shrinking, not so clear. And if we look at suboxic volume, smaller than 5 micromolar, there's only one model that agrees very well with the mean state of oxygen fields, and this predicts an increase in the suboxic volume. And overall, the situation here is not yet very clear, so we can't trust the models very well, at least not the global models. We have regional models that are much better, higher resolved, but these have to be forced at the boundaries and lateral and surface boundaries. So the complete picture, I would say, is not very robust yet, but all indicators that we have hint at a decline of oxygen levels in the low oxygen areas of the eastern boundary uplink system of Peru and Chile. And I would like to end with a longer term legacy. So what will happen? We likely will continue to burn some fossil fuels, probably a lot of fossil fuels. And this is a simulation that you can do in a model here, 8,000 until year 8,000. After about 5,000 gigatons of carbon have been burned in the simulation, and then zero emissions after 2,300. But this model predicts a 2 to 3-fold expansion of suboxic volume, the black line. And this takes thousands of years until this is again ventilated, until again the climate cools in the end, so and CO2 goes away. This is a very long process. So there's a long-term legacy in the oxygen field here. Interestingly, nitrate is lost by denitrification. That's what we expect in larger oxygen minimum zones, suboxic zones, more respiration occurs anaerobically by consuming nitrate or fixed nitrogen. So we have this net loss. And the interesting part here is a net loss of nitrate means a net gain of oxygen, because oxygen is left over. Oxygen is not consumed during respiration. Nitrate is consumed during respiration. So that means we have a net oxygen gain by denitrification. And in a model, we can perfectly diagnose this. That's the green curve here. So the long-term legacy is that a warmer future ocean may even hold more oxygen because of expanding suboxic volumes, expanding denitrification, expanding nitrate loss. This might even be eventually a positive, possibly stabilizing feedback on the extent of oxygen minimum zones we get because of the leftover oxygen produced photosynthetically, which is not consumed during respiration because of the nitrate is consumed. So this is interesting, but well, it all depends on how nitrogen fixers respond, which we don't understand very well, and this is our research agenda here I would like to hint at only. But the take-home message, the interesting part here is expanding oxygen minimum zones may make the ocean more oxic. So this is really surprising, and a surprising result we get from these models, which completely makes sense if you do the stoichiometry of aerobic, anaerobic respiration. So losing nitrate means gaining oxygen, and vice versa. If you fix nitrogen, you lose oxygen. But I think this has some implication for paleo studies, and we have to think about how do we get anoxic oceans, really. It's very difficult, I think at least. And, well, it might even have some political implications that things may be very different than the forcing you apply, and I hope this gives us hope for the future as well. And let's collaborate. This is the big international conference here, and we want to address these questions and resolve and better understand what's going on. And we have set up about a year ago this oxygen website, www.ocean-oxygen.org, where on a daily basis we provide new information. And we will host a conference in Kiel in September, where you are all invited to participate. Abstract submission has been closed, but you can still attend and register. So this is in September in Kiel on deoxygenation. And I thank you for your attention and look forward for your questions.
Thank you, Andreas, for this very exciting talk. I think we have time for a couple of questions. So remember, people love to walk towards the microphone if they'd like to ask any question. Yeah, one coming up. Please do.
Good morning. My comment or question then is how, knowing that you measure dissolved oxygen for a long, long time with Winkler titration method, knowing that was the main way of measuring till perhaps the 80s or the 90s, and now most of the dissolved oxygen is measured by electrochemistry, using this very nice probe. How do you reconcile these two ways of measuring dissolved oxygen because they are completely different, and the errors that could have been done when you use Winkler and when you use electrochemistry could be different. When you use Winkler, you make so many calculations that when you write the last number, the concentration, you're pretty sure what you're doing. When you take the data from the probe, you just take the data and that's it. So how do you reconcile these two methods to make very long time series of data?
Yeah, thank you. Very good point. Well, the time series I showed the last 50 years, that was based on Winkler measurements still. But now we have this problem. We have to intercalibrate the new methods against Winkler, and there are some efforts underway. But I see it is a major challenge. I don't think it's a major problem. We have to solve it, and we have to treat the data and the new data very carefully and validate, calibrate our instruments. This is being done for the Argo program, for example, but I think it's essential to point out what you did just pointed out, and we have to pay due attention to this new device, new techniques. But the last 100 years, almost 100 years, Winkler was there, and that was unique, I think, in oceanography, that we have the same measurement protocol for such a long time. We don't have that for temperature, and so we can, I think, predict, or, well, hindcast, have a much better understanding of oxygen changes, or data set of oxygen changes, not understanding, than of temperature and heat content changes.
Thank you.
Is there any other question? Actually, I have one. Given the knowledge acquired within the German program, how would you see the route forward to go to reconcile oxygen prediction and the observations?
I think what is really needed is consolidated efforts in a few regions where we have time series, high resolution time series data, looking at physical, biochemical, biological processes at the same time to understand the interplay of, well, physics, biology, chemistry. And across strong, steep gradients, oxygen gradients, changing in time and in space. And this is really the critical regions to advance our process understanding. I think that we really need, we lack process understanding. We probably lack process in our models, feedbacks in our models, so particularly positive feedbacks that are missing, to accelerate this, or to model this missing acceleration that we don't get right now. So my strategy would be to identify a few regions where we have coordinated observational campaigns, to multidisciplinary observational campaigns where we can really look at strong oxygen gradients and time variable oxygen gradients, what is going on there.
Okay, thank you. Is there another question? Okay, well, thank you, Andreas, for this very nice talk. And